down soon.
And I'm still seasick.
You are, huh? Hello, everyone, and welcome once again to Primetime Wrestling. Here we are back in the studio with our brand new set. Take a look at it. It's beautiful. No thanks to you. What time did you get off the lake? It was dark when I left. I just...
4 Coast Guard boats had to come out and get me.
Well, you kidding? There's no... Don't touch anything, please. Just don't touch anything. Or you'll be back out there on the lake again. Outstanding lineup once again here this week on Primetime Wrestling. Feature match, of course, the big guy, Bam Bam Bigelow, taking on King Kong Bundy. Where have you been hiding this guy? He's been under wraps.
Oh, no. Bundy's been very, very busy avoiding you and everybody else.
Busy doing what?
None of your business.
Well, Brain, these are the guys that are in your stable, in your family, I beg your pardon. And obviously you don't want us to know what's going on, or that's why you don't have any championships. You keep everything a big secret.
You know what's another big secret?
What?
Where's my phone?
Well, you don't have one yet.
I know that.
I'm working
on it. What, I think the phone used to belong to Topper? There's no phone here.
You don't need one yet. You don't have anybody to call. You've ran out of friends.
Roll it.
You thought Mr. Baseball was your friend, right?
Never heard from him again.
You know, he never showed up, did he? We've got an outstanding lineup, as always, here this week on Primetime Wrestling. We're going to be taking a look at young Sam Houston. Kenny Patera against Dino Bravo in that big tug of war that everybody's talking about proved that Kenny was a little bit smarter and a little bit stronger, did he not?
I don't think so.
You don't think
we'll
so?
We'll get into that a little later, though. We'll discuss that with you right now.
Well, you going to run this now? You ready to take over?
I don't like this chair.
Let's go to our first matchup as George Animal Steel meets the one-man gang of Biggie. Let's go.
You think I can put my feet up on?
No.
This bout is scheduled for one fall with a 30-minute time limit. Introducing first, the manager, the Doctor of Style, Slick. He represents from Chicago, Illinois, weighing 450 pounds, the One Man Gang.
Weighs 500 pounds if he weighs an ounce.
503,
and
maybe.
His opponent, soon to be making his way to the ring area, hails from Detroit, Michigan, weighing 288 pounds, George the Animal
Listen to the ovation for George the Animal Steel. Gorilla Monsoon at ringside here with Bobby the Brain Heenan for this big matchup.
You know, when these people cheer for George Animal Steel, they're just showing their own intelligence, how stupid they are. They're just like animals, same as him. This gang's got him dwarfed by about, I would say, 300 pounds. Looks like,
don't that. The animal with those big right hands, and the big guy went down like a ton of bricks.
They're great wrestling moves, aren't they?
You never know what to expect from the animal, do you?
No, that's why he's probably the most dangerous man in professional wrestling. He doesn't know what to expect from himself. He'll go after a board, a chair, the ring steps, a bell. So what if you disqualify him? What's he going to do with the loser's chair anyway? Blow it on beauty aids?
Well, he tried to get his hands on the Slickster. What's he going to do now? He might take this home. This could be a momentum.
Probably the nicest thing he's ever owned.
Look at the gang. He's not too anxious to get back in there. Oh, look at that. Going to drop an elbow on it. You covered it, George. The referee might count it.
That referee probably would.
Oh, look at that.
Now, this is another man's property. I don't know who George Animal Steel thinks he is. This property does not belong. Now, what's he got there now?
Oh, the hat. Oh, look at him.
I love it.
George Animal Steel mocking the big 500-pounder one-man gang.
It's like a cab driver from Boston here.
Look at the Slickster. He wants his hat back.
Of course he does. Probably a $300-$400
hat. Oh, yeah. Well, he's got it at a garage sale. Distraction. Whoa. Did he get nailed? Yes.
He deserves it. Stealing a man's property like that. Now he's proven himself. He's not only an animal, he's a thief. Shoplifter, probably.
George Animal Steel giving away in excess of 250 pounds here in this matchup. You don't want to get down on the canvas because the one-man gang will put you away in a hurry. And look out for the Slickster. This referee is not very forceful, is he?
None of them are. It all should be replaced by computers. And put me in charge of computer control.
Maybe we'll get you this nice blue shirt and a black bow tie and stick you in there.
I wouldn't mind doing some
fishing. See what kind of bed of roses it is in there as a referee.
I'll dress myself, though. I don't care to wear that drab clothes like they do.
You will wear whatever World Wrestling Federation President Jack Tunney deems fit for you to wear.
No, you watch what's going to happen the rest of this year. Elections are due, you know. Jack Tunney might be out. There might be a new president. The Brain.
Ooh. You? President of the World Wrestling Federation?
Sounds good, don't it?
Highly unlikely.
Nice ring to it.
Everybody outside right now as the Animal's got his eye on the Slickster, but look out from behind. Yep, nailed once again by the Gang.
Watch your count, Gang. You better get back in there. No, you're safe. This referee can only count to two.
Gang wanted him back inside the ring.
See, being a veteran, he's smart enough to know the count. He knows where he's at.
Look out, Irish whip. Boy, went for the clothesline, and the Animal's taking an early lunch. Oh, right over the top rope.
No,
he couldn't get him. Too heavy.
Way too heavy.
He didn't have enough momentum going, did he?
Well, George didn't catch him right, because George isn't a wrestler. He's an animal.
Watch that Slickster. Keep your eye on him, ref. I'm not wasting my breath here.
You know, that's illegal what he's doing. But the Animal did steal his hat. So I feel it's equal. It's fair.
Oh, sure. Oh, he got him now. Big guy right down to the hardwood floor here in Beantown. Take a look up, Gang. That's where you can get a good view of that, 16 or 18 championship banners hanging off the ceiling here.
At least.
A tribute to the Boston Celtics. Could be all over. 1-2. He got him. Wasn't fair, but he got him.
Doesn't matter. He got him. Eventually, I'll be having my banners hanging from the ceiling.
What banners are those?
You'll see.
Give me a break.
President of the World Wrestling Federation. Oh. I hear it now.
Let's get the official word.
The winner of this bout, the One Man Gang.
Looks happy, don't he? Very, very happy.
Here it comes. Let's go back and take a look. Slickster got involved once again, distracting George the Animal Steel. Big guy comes back with that knee right into the kidney area. Obviously knocking the Animal right into the middle of next week.
Now what's he got? Where did he get that cane from?
Well, who do you think it belongs to?
Right.
The referee?
No, you're right. He stole it. He stole somebody's property again.
Belongs to the Slickster, for your information.
I happen to know why he carries that cane.
Why?
He has a chronic hip ailment, and it could go out at any time, and he just has it there just in case.
Well, you must have the same ailment. Is that why you never go into your back pocket or for your wallet?
I keep my wallet in my front. What are you? Any pickpockets now? I'm going to tell you where
I keep
my
money. Look at this. The Animal unloads on the Slickster.
Now, how much does a Slickster weigh, would you say?
What's the difference? 145 pounds?
Dressed and soaking wet. There's no reason for this. Gang's got to get in there and stop him.
I think the Gang's about had all he wants of George the Animal Steel. In fact, if it weren't for the Slickster, I can't honestly see the Gang getting by the Animal.
Look at this. Chef's an official. What would happen now if any member of my family did that? They'd be fined and suspended. But no, they say he's not all there, you know. All his dogs don't bark, so it's okay for him to get away whatever he wants to do. That's not fair. It's not fair at all. I'm going to change all these rules someday.
Well, they say that George the Animal Steel doesn't have both oars in the water, but he knows something he likes when he sees it, and he has a fetish for that top turnbuckle.
Time for Din Din. Now he's destroying property. All he's done is destroy property since he's been here.
Look at the referee. If he'd have done some of that during the match, the result might have been different.
He stole the man's cane, stole the man's hat, stole the man's jacket, and now he's going to eat a turnbuckle.
Seemed like a good idea to me.
Come on, referee, show some authority there. There,
yeah,
now fine him, suspend him right there. He's done. As far as I'm concerned, this Animal's done in professional wrestling.
Hand raised in a token of victory by George the Animal Steel. However, it was in fact the One Man Gang who got the Duke in this one.
And these people stand there and cheer him on. Now he's pointing at you and me.
There he goes.
Who's he after there?
Frenchie Martin getting chased right out of the picture. Didn't belong down there at ringside anyway. What the heck's he doing down there?
Well, he was standing off here to the right a bit talking to some people from France. We're doing a special interview with him.
George Animal Steel rearranging the furniture here in Beantown in Boston Garden.
What's wrong with this guy? You're going to have to give this guy some kind of shock treatment. Now where is he going?
What's the difference? Plenty more action still to come. We'll be back. George Animal Steel, not victorious in Beantown, but was successful in rearranging the appearance of the building.
I wonder what the inside of his house trailer must look like, huh?
What do you mean a house trailer? What makes you think he lives in a house trailer?
He wouldn't live in a normal neighborhood,
would
he?
You stop? Why not?
You see him going out to get the mail in the morning? Opens it, takes the letters out, eats them, leaves. Nice neighbor to have.
Don't talk about George the Animal Steel when you got guys like King Kong Bundy and that type individual in your family establishment. We know what kind of people they
are. Respectable people of the community.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, tell me about it. Talk about respectable people. We're going to be taking a look this week here on Primetime Wrestling at the undisputed World Wrestling Federation champion, the Macho Man, Randy Savage, as he takes on...
Will the First Lady of
Virgil.
Wrestling... Virgil.
How do you like that?
Well, I want to see this one.
You want to see that one, huh?
No doubt. Ted
What's the matter?
Here.
The Million Dollar Man couldn't put away the Macho Man, so now he's sending his stooge in there? Is that the way it works?
I think he did a very good job of almost putting him away.
Also, later on in the program, we're going to get a special update on the former champion, the Hulkster. I'm telling you, we'll have a telephone for you. Gee whiz. You had your portable phone last week. That didn't work for you. You're always complaining about something. Be happy that you're back here inside the studio. You don't have to worry about drowning or anything. You've got a great match coming up with Virgil against the champion, the Macho Man, Randy Savage. What more do you want?
I want you to be gone.
Me to be gone? You saw what happened last time I was gone. Right now, let's take you to ringside as the World Wrestling Federation champion, the Macho Man, takes on Virgil the Bodyguard.
I had everything going smooth.
Smooth?
Gentlemen, this non-title matchup is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first to my right, accompanied by the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. From Palm Beach, Florida, weighing 250 pounds, Virgil. And his opponent,
can you believe this, Jesse? It's definite, McMahon. I'm having a hard time hearing myself.
Watch out now.
You know what interests me here, McMahon? Look at the physique.
Whoa, baby! Whoa!
Look at the physique on Virgil. I'm not sure how much this guy knows about wrestling, but baby, he's put together.
Watch out from behind! Virgil attacking and attacking here.
Well, DiBiase did what he wanted to do right there. He distracted the Macho Man, gave Virgil an opening, and Big Virgil, the Bodyguard's taking full advantage of it.
Move to the buckle. Virgil is mean. And as you spoke up earlier on, really put together. Tremendous power.
You know, that's the difference here. You know, Elizabeth is no help outside the ring. Elizabeth can't do anything but stand there and look beautiful. And that's not going to get the job done.
Virgil moving in on the Macho Man, Randy Savage. After the attack from behind, another whip to the buckles.
And the champ's in trouble early.
Indeed. Series of shoulder blocks. Ted DiBiase, the Million Dollar Man, urging Virgil on. Oh, wait a minute. Come on. Look at this.
Whoa. A little classic example of Virgil tying up referee Dave Hebner and Ted DiBiase doing the dirty work outside. I love it.
Come on, ref. Get in there.
That's my style of wrestling, McMahon.
DiBiase with another cheap shot. And another one. Series of them now. Is Virgil the scratch referee Dave Hebner? Come on, get in there.
Well, you can't blame Hebner. He doesn't have eyes in the back of his head.
The Macho Man up in the air. Big body slam by bodyguard Virgil. He is really powerful. Virgil
going up the ropes.
Yes, indeed. What's going to happen here? Virgil on the very top rope, and he misses.
And the Macho Man had enough presence of mind to get out of the way. Look at the fans are going crazy. They want a rally by the Macho Man.
Here comes the Macho Man, lead to the back.
And Macho's going up. Up.
Top rope, down into Virgil. And Virgil in the air, a slam by the Macho Man. All the way up to the top rope, this could be
it.
Wait
a minute,
there's DiBiase. Just a strike. Oh, he just missed with that right hand.
Oh, DiBiase did a smart move. Macho looked like he was going for that big elbow, and that would have ended the match. Now it's giving Virgil a chance to recover. You got to hand it to him, McMahon. DiBiase's not only rich, he's smart.
Macho Man coming right up after the Million Dollar Man. Whoa, look at that. Can you believe that? Hiding behind Elizabeth. I bet he's hurting her arms. Oh, no. Virgil from behind, Savage.
I'll tell you, DiBiase has definitely done his homework for this bout. Every time Macho amounts some type of offense, DiBiase has something to counter it, whether it be pulling Elizabeth in front. It's brilliant.
Can you believe that? It's not bad enough. You got somebody like Virgil outside the ring most of the time. Now you got the Million Dollar Man outside there putting his hands on Elizabeth.
Hey, she wants to be a manager. She wants to be the first lady of wrestling.
You're the
she
first
wants
to one be... to complain, Brain, when somebody grabs a hold of you out there.
Yes, but hey, she ought to get with it. This is not like trying to get an extra clean free at the
this
laundromat,
went a long way
sweetheart.
From being over.
This
we'll
is
be back
a tough
with
sport.
In just a moment. Duluth, Minnesota could indeed be a disaster area for the Macho Man, Randy. And why are you saying that? You told me you liked it there.
I liked it there because I knew I could get out.
Oh, please. Let's take you back to Duluth right now. Let's go back to ringside as the Macho Man tries to figure out Virgil.
You may be going back. Huh?
Savage whipped to the ropes. Virgil sets him up, and boy, did he ever drive the elbow to the chest. A cover! One! And only two at the most.
I personally think Elizabeth is a detriment.
You made that comment earlier on. The match not over yet. Clothesline by Virgil.
But look what it causes, McMahon.
Cover one, two, and a kick out by the Macho Man.
Macho Man can't concentrate on the bout because he's got to worry about Elizabeth's safety. His head's got to be in two places at once.
Down. Get him down. Oh, my. Randy Savage thrown over the top rope over by Elizabeth by Virgil. And Ted DiBiase distracted the referee as Elizabeth out attending to the Macho Man.
Cool down, Hebner. You're going to have a heart attack. He's getting so fired up in there, the referee. You know, Macho Man's learning
right
now.
Wait a minute. Look at this. Elizabeth now.
And she can't do nothing.
I think. Giving directions in there. I should say out there. Is Ted DiBiase and Virgil following those instructions to the letter. But what's going on? Look at this. Trying to approach Elizabeth with a fistful of $100 bills.
What's he trying to do? Well, DiBiase and Virgil made a cardinal mistake. They took their eyes off the champion.
A scoop! What's happening here now? Drop ball across the top rope by Randy Savage. Savage going to the outside.
He's setting him up for the elbow, McMahon. If he hits it, it's over.
DiBiase's not around this time.
He wins it. I've said it time and time again. $1 million man's going to win the war.
What are they doing to him?
They're working him over.
Won the match fair and square.
They're teaching Macho Man exactly what it's going to be like to be the champion of the world. Everybody's gunning for you. Everyone.
$100 bill in the hand of Ted DiBiase. Oh, they crammed that $100 bill right in the mouth of the Macho Man.
Hey, he's a big tipper, McMahon.
Whoa, no!
Well, we got total chaos now. It's turning into a battle royal.
Randy Savage would like nothing better than to get his hands on the million-dollar man, Ted DiBiase, just one more time. I think the feeling is mutual.
It definitely is. This is far from over, McMahon. There's been nothing settled here in this match.
Wait a minute. Randy Savage has broken loose. Down into the million-dollar man of the Virgil.
You know, I think personally Macho should get out while the getting's good right now.
I think it's Ted DiBiase and company clearing the area, and we'll clear the area as well and return with more World Wrestling Federation action.
Boy, what a display that was.
Savage is a very...
Did you see the concerned look on Elizabeth's face there at the end?
Sure, she never knows who she's going home with. She knows she's going to go home with the Million Dollar Man. Or Macho Man, or she's just going to be out front walking. She has no idea.
She goes with a champion. There's only one champion, Brian. You wouldn't know anything about that because you don't have any champions. Why'd you send Ravishing Rick down there? Isn't he in enough trouble?
He just took off. I didn't send him.
Yeah, just took off, huh?
I don't have nothing to do with my men. They're on their own pretty much.
I understand that he's looking over his shoulder all the time, anticipating Jake the Snake Roberts to be there.
Oh,
after
that's
he did
true.
The show.
That's true. Yeah, the harlot.
What?
The harlot. You know, had he came up to him like a man face to face, you know, you can expect that. But now the way he blindsided me and attacked Ravishing Rick Rude just because she wanted to go
changed.
Home.
Still lying like a rug.
Where's we'll the sign that lights up that says host? By now, I ordered it. Ask for it.
Just be patient. You don't have any patience.
I want my phone.
That's why you couldn't get off that lake. You couldn't. You were on that guy so bad to start that engine. The guy got all excited. He couldn't. Give me a break. Two of the biggest men today in the World Wrestling Federation, referring to the One Man Gang and
Andre the Giant.
No, Bam Bam Bigelow.
Oh,
I didn't say.
He doesn't
the biggest.
Compare.
I said two of the biggest.
Oh,
you can bet that these two guys, somewhere along the lines, somewhere along the way, are going to clash heads.
I'll take a payphone.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sean Mooney with this special report. Men of awesome size are not an uncommon sight in the World Wrestling Federation, but there exist two wrestlers in particular who not only possess great bulk, but incredible athletic prowess as well. Bam Bam Bigelow and the One Man Gang have a combined weight of nearly 700 pounds. Yet separately, each displays in the ring the athletic agility of a much smaller athlete.
Wait a minute, look at this. Over the rope, down across the chest, cutter, and two in. Yes, sir.
A reversal now, Hardy to the corner goes Bam Bam. Here comes Sharp, nobody there.
Remember, McMahon, it's not how you play the game. It's whether you win or lose.
Ooh, my goodness. Well, that's the way the one-man gang plays the game right there. An easy three count.
Look at this. Uh-oh. Here it comes. Oh, he nailed him with it. Face first, forget about it. Stick the fork in Mancini.
Why?
He's done.
With each possessing such impressive agility, it seemed only logical that the two were destined to meet. That confrontation did indeed take place at WrestleMania 4 with explosive results.
He's going to be one unhappy manager if he loses the one-man gang.
Headbutt right between the eyes.
Both his people go down in the first round.
Switchster indeed would be a desperate individual here. Oh, beautiful headbutt. Bam Bam seems to be in control of this one. coming off the ropes. Look out. Oh, look at that. Did you see that? The Slickster pulled the top rope down.
I didn't do nothing.
No, did you hear that? He said he didn't do nothing.
What a desperate move that was.
No, Slick said he didn't
if
do nothing.
If the referee saw that, that's a disqualification.
Referee obviously didn't say, I don't know what you're talking about, Gorilla.
Yes, I saw it. Are you watching, Jess? Are you paying attention?
I'm paying attention. I don't know how you can see with those cloudy bifocals of yours.
Those are your box seats down there, right? Donald Trump, it happened right in front of him. He saw it.
What happened? Count out?
Upon the conclusion of their match at WrestleMania 4, a bitter rivalry was born. The intensity of these two men and their demands for a rematch ensure that Bam Bam Bigelow and the one-man gang will once again collide in the ring. With this special report, I'm Sean Mooney.
Sean Mooney, the latest...
What's his name?
Sean Mooney.
He used to sell books at the airport.
No, he never sold anything at the air host.
Different
he,
kind
he's
of
the
a
latest
Mooney.
Acquisition here to the broadcast team of the World Wrestling Federation and doing an outstanding job at that. Talk about big guys that are in trouble.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Andre the Giant. Let's
sure.
talk about Hacksaw Jim Duggan putting the wood to the big guy.
Fine. Now, if he'd have knocked him down, then I could make
knocked
excuses.
Knocked him down?
With
he not only
fist.
Knocked him down, he knocked him out for eight
with
minutes.
With his fist. But no, he had to use a board.
Well, Brian, you get special time right now as we're going to go to this special live interview with you and Andre the Giant, and we'll get your side of the
Roll
story.
It.
Ladies and gentlemen, please greet my guests. Of course, the eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant. And his manager, Bobby the Brain Heenan, who once again has Andre the Giant under his wings, and I guess along with that, a giant problem, Mr. Heenan, and I'm talking about Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
You call that a giant problem? Hacksaw Duggan has a giant problem. 7'5", over 500 pounds of a giant problem. He's telling everybody how with one swing of the 2x4, he leveled this man. Oh yeah, you knocked him down with a good cheap shot. But he's up, and once he's up, he stays up.
You know what happened in that recently nationalized televised match, Andre? If I recall correctly, Hercules and Mr. Heenan held back Hacksaw Jim Duggan as you flailed away with lefts and rights.
I want to tell you, Greg DeGeorge, Jigsaw Jim Duggan, why just that? This is nothing. You will see when I'll be finished with you, Axel. Because believe me, what is coming to you, you're going to suffer and suffer, Jim Duggan. Take me quite a while to come up here, but you're going down, Jim Duggan. And I will squeeze that little neck you get on you until you have to know why.
You know one thing Mr. Duggan has going for?
And believe me, when I'm finished with him, he'll be done.
One thing Mr. Duggan does have going for him is the fact that he knocked out Andre the Giant, and no one has ever done that, Mr. Heenan.
Well, no, he's never been hit with a 2x4 before either. You can knock out a charging bull if you hit him with a 2x4. Don't give me that card.
Well,
with all due respect to you, Andre, I know you've heard it before, and after talking with Hacksaw Jim Duggan the other day, I would bet you may be hearing ringing in your ears one day.
Ho! Oh! Well, I think we've heard the last of this idiot.
Sure, you can squash a 120-pounder, but when you get somebody that weighs 245 or 250 and has a 2x4 in his hand,
Duggan's
it's a different
closer to 290, right? And he's got a 2x4. Oh, he's a dangerous person. Anybody that would walk up to Andre the Giant and challenge him is a dangerous person because they're not all there. And then hit him with a 2x4 and knock him out?
You did a lot of rationalizing there, Brain, but for my money, it was the same song and dance. The guy was laying down flat on his back in the center of the ring for over 8 minutes, unconscious, and you were unable to do anything about it.
Had we hit Duggan with the board, would you have backed us the same way? You'd say no.
Sorry. I know right out there right now, folks watching, are a lot of nonprofit organizations.
Give me my phone.
Looking for outstanding ways to raise money for whatever their worthy cause may be. And the World Wrestling Federation can help you do just that. For more information, write Fundraisers, P.O. Box 3858, Stamford, Connecticut, 06905. And please, folks, include your phone number where they can get back to you. Don't touch this. It's not for you. Well, everything you see, you want to get your grubby hands on. This is a special WWF Fan Club material. We'll be back.
Give me cash, man.
Wow, look at the power bio by Sharp. But the dropkick works effectively for Jeff Sanders, and now the arm drag. Another one, though. Sharp trying to stop him.
Stuff moving out. I don't know. You asking me?
Yes, I'm asking
this
you.
This is some of the material you get when you join the WWF Fan Club. This is a beautiful pin that you can wear on your lapel, and I showed you the patch before, and I'll show you the pictures and later on. The best thing about the big poster?
Yeah,
you're not on it. That's the best thing about it.
Another
exciting match coming up right now. Young Sam Houston taking on Iron Mike Sharp, one of the roughest, toughest guys
here. I had
here
a phone. I know.
Let's go to ringside.
This bout is scheduled for one fall. Introducing in the ring, from Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, weighing 271 pounds, Iron Mike Sharp. And his opponent, soon to be making his way to the ring area, hails from Waco, Texas, weighing in at 229 pounds, Sam Houston.
Here comes the dancer. Gorilla Monsoon at ringside here in Beantown, along with Bobby the Brain Heenan. You gotta like the style of this guy, man.
I do. Why?
Because he's young, he's exciting. He's a lot of the things that you're not.
You've heard of American Bandstand and Dance Fever and Soul Train.
Sure.
Ever see this guy dance?
Yeah.
He should be on a show called Hit Train.
Oh,
first one out of town.
You're just jealous.
Because I can't, look at this. He's trying to kick a rock out of his shoe. That's uncoordination right there.
He knows how to do that two-step.
But is he going to be able to wrestle Mike Sharp?
Well, he's going to have to do a lot more than a two-step.
Look, his name is Houston. Wears a cowboy hat, neckerchief, shafts, Star of Texas, flag of Texas, cowboy boots. What would he wear if he'd have been born in Newark?
What would he be? Probably the same thing.
Yeah, it doesn't matter there.
Referee's going to have his hands full with this one.
Sharp outweighs him by, maybe by 30, 40 pounds.
Yeah, but you see, Houston's going to rely on that speed, that agility, that cunningness.
You know the old saying, a good fast man will always fall down in front of a good big man.
What does that mean? I didn't get the drift of that at all.
Well, I mean, you go so fast, you wind up tripping yourself, and you're just going to be snatched by the big guy. He's going to throw you to the ground. That's why I manage nothing but big guys.
There's an old saying, Brain, that I have always believed in strongly, and that is that a good little man never, ever beat a good big man.
And the bigger you are, it's harder to make them fall.
Unless you have a 2x4.
Skip it.
Oh. Whoa, there's the power of Iron Mike.
This kid better go back to one of those old country and western water holes he hangs around, get on that mechanical bull, because he'd stand a better chance than he will with Mike Sharp.
Well, Iron Mike Sharp, a surprise to me that he's not like any other member of the Sharp family that I knew. His father wasn't of that temperament that he is. His father was a relatively quiet guy. And of course, he had another uncle who, along with his father, was at one time tag team champions of the world, were they not?
1927, yes, it was.
It was not 1927.
Well, I'm not sure of the year. I just made a stab at it. You know, this Houston has knocked over quite a few big contenders lately. You know, he's an up-and-rising star.
Yeah, like Dangerous Danny Davis, for one.
Well, I think it was a fluke, but...
Did he get his hand raised?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's all. Case closed. Oh, drop kick caught him right in the kisser. And a nice arm drag by young Sam Houston.
He's got him, Mike. Watch this. Hold him.
Up over the top. Beautiful maneuver. There's the leverage. Well, once again, the SRO signs went out early here in Boston.
It's because I'm here.
Standing room only. Boston Bruins are going for the Stanley Cup. Exciting.
Where's the Celtics? They're looking to notch another NBA championship. And some of the greatest professional wrestling in the world goes down right here in Beantown at the Boston Garden.
And there's rumor, you know, they got the flags for all the championships of the NBA that the Celtics have won, and the Stanley Cup flags that the Bruins have won. And I hear they're going to eventually hoist the flag up of me.
What? Maybe they'll hoist you up, period.
Not me, they will.
What's the flag going to say?
Manager of the Year, host. A lot of things I've accomplished.
You didn't win Manager of the Year award.
Well, years ago, it was beaten out of me by Mean Gene Okerlund. Bad addition. Couldn't add up anything.
Now you're talking about becoming the next World Wrestling Federation president?
Yes, and I will not have a running mate.
You will not.
I'll do it all by myself.
That'll be a mistake for young Sam Houston if he wants to test strength with Iron Mike Sharp.
Calling mine the Brain Coalition.
The Brain Coalition.
Yeah, you can't vote for me unless you have an IQ of over 175. To all you people at home, that leaves you out. Sit on the sofa there, you couch potatoes.
Crowd here in Beantown, very boisterous.
I may have Miss Betty run with me.
Oh, that'll be nice. She does a lot of running, I understand. Mostly downhill.
Are you saying she's on her way out with the brakes on?
I didn't say that. If the shoe fits, well, you put it on. Boy, really complaining vehemently here to the referee.
Well, Mike is a very volatile person.
This referee's name, Brian. Freddie
the Freeloader.
It's not Freddie the Freeloader. Oh, look at that.
Steady Freddie.
Steady Freddie.
And he's not too ready.
I knew Sam Houston wouldn't fare too well with this particular move. Big mistake to stick your fingers in there with Iron Mike.
But I'll tell you something about this Houston. You know, as much as I've been sitting here telling the truth about him, he does have... He's very tall and lanky, which he has that tendon strength. Watch, he's coming up off that. He should have blocked that. See, had I been in there, I would have immediately blocked it, gone behind him.
I understand of late, Brain, that you must be sick or something. You're a glutton for punishment. You're putting the tights on again.
Well, I've had a couple of challenges thrown my way, and I...
Don't you have enough money?
Yes, I do, but you can always use a little running cash.
Oh, please.
So I just put down on a piece of paper to the World Wrestling Federation what it would cost to get me in the ring, a percentage of the gate, this and that. They were fools. I mean, they thought it was right, and they met my offers, my demands, and I've been turning to the ring for a few matches here and there, another few victories in my belt.
Well, I think it's a big mistake, personally.
Challenge me? I do, too.
Oh, nice move, nice leverage move. He got him down on the canvas where he belongs, where he wants him.
I may challenge Savage.
You may challenge Savage.
You never know.
No, nothing you do would surprise me, Brian.
Just think, I could manage the World Wrestling Federation champion and be it.
That would be interesting, would it not?
I'm the only person that could blow smoke up. No.
No, let's not get into that. Iron Mike on the outside. Taking a little breather here. Where's he going? Forget about it. He's gone to the locker room. You know, when you do that, Brain, you don't even get the loser's share of the money if you walk out.
No, you're gone.
You get nothing.
Nothing.
Close your eyes. What do you see?
Nothing.
That's what you get when you walk out. Well, he's back in a hurry. What a feather would be in the cap of young Sam Houston if he can get by Iron Mike Sharp.
The last thing he wants is a feather. He's a cowboy.
Look at this.
Oh, ooh. I like that sound. It's his skull going into the turnbuckle.
Sharp's been very successful here in Beantown for one reason or another. You know, he likes this town. Irish whip in. Look out.
Oh. I think I'm going to go over to Ernie's and get my WrestleMania money.
You are?
Yeah, the restaurant. Ernie Tucci.
You mean Joe Tucci?
Oh.
Not Ernie Tucci.
Well, it was a double or nothing bet, and I won this year.
No, you lost. Lost both times.
No, I said I'd win in WrestleMania.
Yo, a case of champagne. Almost a three count there. In fact, the last time we were there, he mentioned that you'd been very conspicuous by your absence.
Well, maybe I'll head over to Mike's and get him some donuts. Doesn't look like he could use any more champagne.
Sam Houston in trouble here. in the Boston Garden. Look out. Oh, what an elbow. Well placed. Could be all over. Well, he came out the back door. Sharp never bothered to hook a leg or anything.
Well, he figured he had him. Mike told me he feels that his wrist has gotten worse.
His wrist?
Yes.
You mean that naggy 9-year-old injury?
Yeah, he says it must be the weather or something, but it's flaring up again.
Look out, atomic drop, nailed him.
Now, he didn't hook the leg, see?
No, he didn't.
Well, you don't expect him to. He's not
that
bright.
I don't believe he could have held Mike down if had he hooked the leg.
You know, he likes to bulldog this kid. Did you know that?
From any angle.
And not only in the ring. I mean, out in the prairie.
Oh, he does not.
Oh, he's been involved in some rodeos and everything.
But not on the prairie. Give me a break.
Well, whatever you call it out there, the sagebrush or the yippee-i-yo.
Oh, please.
Or give me a home or Houston Rome.
Don't sing.
Show you a messy house.
Look out, double axe handle. Don't eat. Oh.
But can you imagine how dumb a guy's got to be to get on a horse going 25 miles an hour, then jump off that horse onto a cow going 35 miles an hour, and then wrestle the cow to the ground just to win a belt buckle and Sarah Jane Schwartz, whatever her name is, the rodeo queen of East Albuquerque?
Well, that's almost as ridiculous as a guy of your age putting on the wrestling tights and climbing back into the ring.
My age? I'm in my prime.
Oh, look at this!
Oh. Tried to hold the trunks. You see that?
Brain, it's all downhill as far as getting inside the squared circle for you anymore. I got news for you.
How did I fare at WrestleMania 4?
You hid.
Right?
You wore some ridiculous outfit that you're not allowed to wear anymore.
Got away with it. But what happened at the end? Was my hand raised in victory?
Your hand was raised in victory. However, you Yippee! Haven't heard the last from Coco, have you?
Coco better
Don't
stay.
Don't you remember that it's only been a few months gone by since you wore that horrid neck brace out here for so long? You forgotten about that?
I don't
that?
Like to think of that.
Oh! Must be a neck roll out here.
Well, he hit the four harder than Larry Bird's ever hit it here.
Iron Mike Sharp in control of this one. As the youngster just got a taste of the hardwood, just like the big guy, Andre, got a taste of the hardwood at the hands of Hacksaw.
Rub it in. Rub it in, man. You wouldn't be saying this if he was out here.
Who?
Andre.
Oh, rammed right into the steel barricade, and it didn't budge very much. Certainly going to be a long evening for young Sam Houston here in the North End.
Well, that's how they usually find him, out behind the Dew Drop Inn out back about 6 in the morning. A couple of the old cowpokes went out back and had a talk with him. Wow, what hit me. Shouldn't have had that last light.
Reminds me of a guy I ran into one night, had a few mudslides. Look at this. Oh, wide open.
His best bet right now is to crawl under that ring.
And hide.
Yes.
Well, just get up and take a walk. Don't leave yourself in a position where the guy in the ring can still get at you when you're not fully recuperated.
It's in the water.
What water?
Texans.
Ooh! Oh. Brain, you see what you got to look forward to when you put on the wrestling gear? Those kind of things.
Yeah, but you got to get me in a position to do that.
That would be hard.
You may be talking to the next World Wrestling Federation champion soon. Stranger things have happened.
Yeah. I could get rid of you and have the Macho Man as a guest.
No, I don't mean that.
Oh. Look out, Irish whip, no reversal by the youngster, hard into the corner. Monkey flip coming up. He got him over, I'm surprised.
I wouldn't even want that belt. I wouldn't even want that championship.
Obviously, you don't want anybody else in the stable to have it either, right?
No, because having that championship, you probably have Elizabeth hanging around all the time when you go to cheap boutiques and buy those gaudy dresses. I don't have time for that.
Look out, reversal once again, this time behind Mike. Oh, he got him with a bulldog.
He won't get him, though.
He went for that elbow.
He won't hook him. I bet you he doesn't.
He hooks the leg. Yes, he did. Well, he got him.
Like I was saying, I knew he'd hook him.
Youngster with enough sense to hook that leg after that bulldog out of nowhere.
Told you so.
I don't know whether it take the kind of beating that he took for the victory is really worth it, though. Let's get the official word.
Sam Houston.
Sam Houston with his hand raised in a token of victory here in Beantown. A big victory over Iron Mike Sharp. Youngster's got a lot to be proud of.
Well, here, just like I was saying, he throws him in the ropes here. But Sam, as smart as he is and as good as he is, use that bulldog on him. Turns him over, hooks the leg. Oh, look
What's this here? What's this? Danny Davis out of nowhere. He doesn't have any business out here. Come on, ref, do something.
He's dancing.
Well, now we've got another ref in there. Now there's three of them. The three of them together couldn't get locked up.
See, Davis was the best referee ever in the World Wrestling Federation.
Kidding?
And he's trying to set these guys straight on the proper rules. What he did was not against the rules because the match was over. He can go any place and beat up anybody anytime he wants.
That's why he got 10,
right? Oh, look at Houston. Looks like maybe it was something he ate.
Danny Davis obviously not happy with when he met young Sam Houston and got the short end of the stick,
well,
so to speak.
Yippee-yi-yo-ki-yi.
Plenty more action still to come here from Beantown. Gorilla along with the Brain Sand. We'll be right back. Well, Danny Davis always sticking his nose in, just like you, where it don't belong.
Boy,
and sooner or later, he's going to have to pay.
I didn't do nothing in that match. I just was impartial and called it as I saw it.
I still think, you know, we talked during that match about you putting the tights back on, and I still don't think it's a good idea. You know, you're not 21 anymore, Brain.
No, but 6-7 years down the road don't mean it doesn't make you...
6-7 years and down the road where? What are you kidding? Are you joking or what?
You know, getting back to another very important item right here, the tug of war is coming up very soon.
Yeah, between who? You and I? No, between Dino Bravo and Ken Patera. I think that Dino Bravo...
The last thing I want is to pull you over on this side of the desk.
Don't even think of touching the set, the new set. Just
and call
leave
my builder, Don.
As is.
Be here like that.
To do what?
Set this whole place up.
Oh, please. We'll be right back with a tug of war in just a moment. Don't go away.
I could get him here right now.
Look at Bravo calling for all his words. However, he's getting closer to that front line.
This is only part of the stuff, Brain. There's a whole box of stuff down here. You look at this. This is one of the exciting items you get.
Whoa.
When you joined the World Wrestling Federation.
Oh, Elizabeth's on there.
Everybody's
Jimmy
on
Hart.
There but you. You're not on
Coco
here.
Coco Beware on there. Jake the Snake.
I said everybody that's of importance but you. But this, along with a whole lot of other paraphernalia that you get, when in fact you join the World Wrestling Federation fan club, and you'll find all the information on how to join in the WWE magazine. Right now, let's go to the tug of war between Bravo and Kenny Patel.
Both guys will have one end of the rope, and the first individual to be able to pull the other across that line will be declared a winner.
I knew that. Patera's got the advantage.
Patera's got the advantage. Why has Patera got the advantage?
Got all the humanoids here chanting USA.
Yeah.
Frenchie doesn't like that. Neither does Dino.
Well, get Frenchie out of the ring, ref. That's your first move. Get the guy out of there.
Speaks 8 languages fluently, I understand.
Who's that?
Frenchie Martin.
Oh. I didn't know that.
Quite an educated man.
Yeah. Couldn't prove that by me.
Well, that's the strongest man in the world he's managing.
Who said?
Frenchie told me.
Yeah. Who, Frenchie and the body. Those are the only two guys I know that agree to that remark.
No. Dino does.
Oh, well, there's three. I'm sorry. Referee finally putting Frenchie Martin out of there. Patera concerned, and rightly so. He's not above doing anything. Devious.
Look at the upper body on Dino Bravo. It doesn't even match Patera.
Patera's much larger, you mean?
No, he's much smaller.
Oh.
Now, they tie this around their waist?
Well, they could do. They can tie it if they like. They don't have to. They can wrap it around and give them a little extra leverage. For me, I've had a few tug-of-wars over the years, and I like the rope to be shorter. Oh!
He's cheating.
He hasn't started yet. The referee hasn't officially started it yet. Once again, the tape is in the center of the ring. Each man will be allotted so much footage either side of it, and the first one to pull his opponent across will be declared a winner.
See, now that's not fair.
What's not fair?
All these humanoids chanting USA, it upsets Mr. Bravo.
Well, do you think it's fair that these two guys walk out here carrying a sign that says USA is not okay?
Freedom of speech.
Freedom of speech.
Well, I guess that's what the people are doing, right?
That's it.
But it's not fair.
You got it. Referee trying to get them to at equal distance from that black mark. And it'll start. They're just about there now. What is he complaining about?
Well, I think Patera has a slight advantage.
They both got gloves on.
No, I think Patera had more rope.
That's up to the referee. We're looking at a far angle here, Brain. He's right there in the ring.
Yeah, but he is Joey Morella. He's incompetent. Frenchie. They should let Frenchie conduct
this. Oh, yeah. A real impartial guy, right?
You've noticed that, too, about
him. I'm sure you've had a lot of sleepless nights over Joey Morella. Oh, he started it. They both were at equal distance.
No, Patera. Patera's closer. Frenchie's got, Dino's got the advantage.
Well, I think it started that way. Look at Bravo pulling for all he's worth. However, he's getting closer to that back line. Look at Patera. Look at the arms power, the shoulders.
If I was there, I'd turn my back, put it over my back, and I'd pull.
Yeah, but you're not there. You're here.
Well, they're lucky.
Oh, look at this. Now it's Bravo who's got the upper hand as he's leaning straight
back. He's got him going. He's sliding.
Patera seems to be losing some footing in there. He came very close to the line. But look at the former Olympian. Now, oh, look at that. He gave up. He realized he was going to be pulled across.
No, he didn't realize that at all. Dino Bravo's just taken over. See, I believed, from my vantage point, that Patera had wrapped that rope around his waist and was cheating. He had tied it in a knot.
Look at this. Come on, Ruff. Get that guy out of there. Frenchie doesn't belong in there. Patera had the man beat. Had him just about pulled over the line. And Bravo, realizing that, went across, shot him. Oh, look at this.
You pulled it the wrong way. Lynch him, lynch him. Pull him backwards.
Oh, referee's down. We're going to need some additional help here.
Well, Frenchie's there. That's good enough for me.
Yeah, sure. In the meantime, Patera's getting choked out here. We have some additional referees in the ring. And look at Bravo. What a vengeance.
Well, what do people chant for? The National Guard?
Look at Patera. He's just about out. What a despicable display by Bravo and Frenchie.
Well, he asked for it.
What do you mean he asked for it?
He was shooting off his mouth. He's been jealous of Bravo ever since he bench pressed 712 pounds.
What a cheap shot that was.
Viva la France!
Canadian strongest man got beat, Brain.
I don't think so. Look, who's laying on the mat? Choked out.
Let's go back and take a look and you can decide for yourself. Patera, pulling away here, just about had him over the line. Look at that. He knows he's beat right there, Brain. He gave it up, went across, a cheap shot into the throat of Patera.
Well, I didn't want to bring this up earlier, but I believe Patera had more ring than Bravo did. The line wasn't really in the middle.
Will you stop, Brain? When they started, it was Bravo. Right now, he's choking away. The rope wrapped around the neck of the former Olympian, cutting off all the air supply.
Oh, I love it.
What a vicious individual. We'll be back right after
this. I love it.
What did he prove? He proved that he, number one, lost to Ken Patera, who in my book is the world's strongest human being. And number two, that he is a very unhappy loser, a crybaby and a back jumper.
Well, Patera didn't look too good as they carried him out, did he?
But that was after the fact. That had nothing to do with the tug of war. That had to do with double teaming. By that double dealing. I'm gonna see if I can't get these guys paid in Canadian money from now on. See how they like that.
What do you mean? That's why they're here, so they can make the American money.
Well, that's too bad, isn't it? That would be too bad for them, wouldn't it?
What are you, in charge of Treasury of the United States now?
No, but I am a personal friend of the World Wrestling Federation President Jack Tunney, happens to be Canadian.
You better start buttering me up, pal. I just may be the president someday.
Yeah? President of what?
The World Wrestling Federation.
Give me a break. We're going to be back in just a moment with a man who is the master of the figure four leg lock, referring to the hammer. We'll be right back.
You would sit on that piece of paper?
We're back, folks. An outstanding matchup coming up. The Poet Laureate of the World Wrestling Federation, Leaping Lanny Poffo, taking on the master of the figure four leg lock, referring to the Hammer Valentine, who has put a number of people out of commission, Brain.
Well, you can name him. Chief J. Strongbow, we put on the shelf. Tito Santana had to go in for knee surgery. I mean, the man
plus
is...
Plus a whole host of others that... Awesome. The guys who were not the caliber of Chief J. Strongbow and Tito Santana, whose careers were literally
Some
ended.
Guys even changed their names.
Oh, let's not get into that. Right now, let's take it to Winston-Salem.
This contest is scheduled for one fall. First of all, introducing to my right, from Downers Grove, Illinois, weighing 254 pounds, Leaping Lanny Poffo. And at this time, Mr. Poffo has a poem for us all.
Oh, no.
It looks like Greg the Hammer's lost a little off the top. He must have been a customer of Beefcake's barber shop.
Hello, everybody. Lord Alfred Hayes here, ringside.
South, Jimmy Hart,
and alongside me,
from Seattle, Washington, weighing 249 pounds.
Hang on for this announcement.
The Hammer Valentine.
As I was saying, alongside me, my colleague, Bobby the Brain Heenan.
You know something, Alfred? Every time this Leaping Lanny, the Poet Laureate, reads one of those ridiculous poems to the guy in the ring, the guy winds up mopping the ring with him. Wouldn't it ever occur to him to keep his mouth shut, maybe say something nice like, I'll think of something. You go ahead.
Well, Poffo certainly doesn't seem to be doing too well right now. You're right, Heenan. In fact, that's a tremendous slam there by Valentine, who is going to work very, very quickly in this bout.
Roses are red, violets are blue. I like Greg, you better too. Wouldn't that save him from getting his keister kicked?
I don't know about that, but he did find himself in a little bit of trouble there in the beginning of this match. However, he's managed to overcome that adversity that he suffered initially here, and he's coming back with some really heavy elbows against Valentine, who he's got cornered.
You know, Leaping Lanny is a very good gymnast and a very capable wrestler. How is he going to do all those flying aerial moves with that knee busted? Because I got a hunch Greg the Hammer's got plans for his leg.
Greg the Hammer's got plans for everybody, Bobby, and mind you, that wasn't such a good move on his part there. He had Poffo going and just threw him out of the ring. However, he's following that up now, and he better get back into the ring quite quickly because the referee's
putting
that count on him.
Tell him, Jimmy. That's the ring, straight ahead, Poffo.
Poffo in a lot of trouble here, but trying to get everything back, trying to get those cobwebs out of his head, but runs straight into a heavy hammer from Valentine.
It's kind of like he didn't even know where the ring was.
Valentine going for a standing suplex. He's got him up, balances him, brings him over, but that's a peculiar type suplex. I've never seen Valentine maneuver that particular hold before, or in that style. Heavy headbutt to the inside thighs of Poffo. And Valentine once again snaps it in a front headlock.
What are the people chanting? Is that Beefcake? People just try to take advantage of somebody, don't they?
I think Bobby there alluding to the fact they'd like to see Beefcake in there giving him, Valentine that is, a haircut.
Well, what's to say Valentine wouldn't take those clippers away and cut that lousy haircut of Brutus the Barber Beefcake?
Poffo coming back with some tremendous right hands. And Valentine trying to cover up, mostly in vain. But he's so strong and so powerful.
I'll tell you, Poffo did launch a pretty good attack here. Bear and I've seen him in a few matches.
Well, Valentine, we've seen him time and time again take a lot of punishment and just absorb it. Simply is absolutely impervious.
My guy used to tell my ex-co-host, Gorilla Monsoon, that the harder you beat on Greg the Hammer and the longer you beat on, the tougher he gets.
He certainly does. Bobby, you're right there. Reversal. Back into that corner and a miss. A catastrophic miss there by Poffo.
Looks like he
landed heavily on the back of his head.
looked like he was thrown from a roller coaster, doesn't it?
Big hammer there. Once again by Valentine. He's going for that figure four.
Yep, go ahead, Greg. You got my permission.
He's making that sign.
Snap it.
He's got it in and locked it up.
Tell me the last person you saw offered that could break out of it.
Locked on, and the referee is asking Poffo now, and he doesn't have to ask anymore because Poffo's given it.
You tell me the last person you saw break this hold. I haven't seen anybody.
Greg, the Hammer Valentine.
A very competent and convincing victory by that man there, Greg the Hammer Valentine.
I'd like to see this again. See, Poffo made the move. He was committed. Maybe he should be committed. But this is just about the end.
Good victory for Valentine. We'll be right back after this.
The Hammer chalking up another very impressive victory in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, which incidentally is a hotbed for the WWE brain, is it not?
Oh, it certainly is. You know, sitting there listening to me laugh, I had the break in the laughter thinking about everybody's talking about Greg the Hammer Valentine's leg brace, or the guard he has on his leg. Like, you made mention to it a while back that he didn't have it on there because this match was before he injured
his calf. He's gold-bricking, just like you did all those months.
If I had been born in 42, you'd have blamed me for the war.
Probably you had something to do with it.
Nothing to do with it. The reason he wears that is a protective move. He doesn't use it during the match, but when he does apply that figure four, he turns it around to protect a damaged calf muscle.
Why doesn't he have it on in that direction when the match begins to protect that same calf muscle? Would you like to answer that?
Well, not being a surgeon or a chiropractor,
but
I don't know.
But being a journalist, you might want to look into it.
I would if I had a phone.
We'll be back in just a moment with a
former
WWE champ,
the Hulkster. Don't just stick your finger up in the air at me.
Certainly hasn't lost any of his steam referring to the former World Wrestling Federation champion, the Hulkster, Hulk Hogan. This guy, his dynamic personality has carried him past and beyond everything, Brain. He is hotter now than ever.
Who?
Who? What are you, an owl? Who?
Who?
The guy who has destroyed everything that you tried to build. The guy who made it so that there isn't one piece of gold in the Heenan family.
My tax man.
Referring to the former champion, the Hulkster himself. Roll it, please. Update.
Hello, everyone. This is Lord Alfred Hayes with this week's update. That incredible feeling of elation and tingling excitement that Hulk Hogan creates within the heart of all sports fans is called Hulkamania. Last week on Superstars, Hulkamania was at its zenith. Let's join it again.
Hogan's on a roll right here. He's got to follow it up.
Off the rope. Drops the leg. Cover. 2, 3 yards. Hulk Hogan. Big hammer. Leg drop by Nikolai Volkov.
As we can also breathlessly see, Hulkamania is running wilder than ever. With update, I'm Lord Alfred Hayes.
Is he something else or is he something else?
Certainly. Do you know I'm on the new WWE ice cream bars?
You are not. Will you stop? Just like I suppose you were going to be on the watch, too, that the World Wrestling Federation has
put out. Here's a shot of this. Zoom in here. Earn your money.
How many of those have you seen on the market?
I have over 11,000 at home in a freezer.
I'm sure you do.
What are my friends and guests?
We're going to talk about the WWE ice cream bars because the hot weather is rapidly approaching. But right now we're going to go to an interview with Brutus, the barber beefcake, the man who does the cutting and the strutting.
I'd like to introduce you to a man you know as the barber. Please welcome Brutus.
Didn't he styles his own hair, McMahon?
All right, Barber. On the spot, let's talk about some unfinished business. Of course, I'm referring to WrestleMania 4. I guess you could say you went 1 for 2 there. You did give the Mouth of the South a much-needed haircut, but you didn't get the coveted Intercontinental Championship. Your thoughts?
Well, my thoughts are this. When Jimmy Hart's hair was flying in the air, I got the fear of God in him. You know, it's going to be amazing to me if he shows his face around here again. But the Honky Tonk Man, I'm not finished with you yet. I'm not finished with you yet either. What are you doing out here? This is my interview. You got a lot of nerve coming out here, Jimmy Hart, because I can finish the job that I started to do on you and turn you into a cue ball.
That's gutsy by Jimmy, don't you think? He's confrontating, coming one-on-one with him.
What are you doing? Get out of here.
Wait a minute. From the heart. Oh,
whoa. No.
Wow!
Somebody said my guitar wasn't tuned up. That's the only way I know how to tune it. If you think that played a mean tune, you ain't heard nothing yet.
What? Get him! Get him away from there! Get him away from there! Hey, McManus just he told you he was tuning his guitar. He's gonna get his. He's definitely going to get his.
That's a mean tune.
Brutus the Barber being assisted. Look at that, Jesse Ventura. Bleeding all the way down from the back of the head. Right down the back.
Hey, Honky thumped him. What do you expect?
We'll be right back right after this commercial break. Stay with us with more World Wrestling Federation action.
Another despicable display by the Colonel and the Honky Tonk Man. You sit there and tell me that this guy is the greatest Intercontinental Champion of all time and he does stuff like that? Give me a break.
What about all the guys Beefcake cut their hair, sprayed him with paint?
After he beat him right in the middle of the ring, yes.
Choked him into unconscious, disfigured people.
Didn't back jump anybody.
He choked him into unconsciousness. Doesn't matter. Honky Tonk, my hat goes off to you.
You condone that, right?
I would have done it in a different way. I'd have used a Wurlitzer.
Oh, will you?
About an 8,000 pound, but I wouldn't have hit him from behind.
You condone that.
I dropped it from the ceiling.
I'll tell you what I condone, Brain. Have you gotten any of these lately? This one, Strike Force, referring to the World Wrestling Federation ice cream bar. These things, what is that?
That's me. They're known as the Bobby the Brain Heenan ice cream bars.
Oh, they are not.
They are
too. World Wrestling Federation superstar bars.
Well, that's why they're selling so hot, because...
Yeah, yours aren't selling at all. You got them all locked up in the freezer at home, I understand.
For guests that come over.
Oh, will you stop. As always, action galore here on Primetime Wrestling. Right now, we're going to go to the Young Stallions in a tag team matchup.
Another round of bars.
Exciting, in great shape, and know a whole lot about professional wrestling.
And their biggest asset is they never quit smiling.
and never quit smiling.
Disgusts me. Why can anybody be that happy? That many days in their life.
Look out, Irish whipping. I don't see the Heenan family, especially referring to the Islanders, very anxious to sign the dotted line where the Stallions are concerned.
I have open contracts with every promotion in the World Wrestling Federation.
You do.
With Jack Tunney and everybody. But no, nobody wants to get in the ring with the Islanders. Can you blame them?
Well, Islanders indeed, a rough duo. Quick tag made now. Scantor gets back in and runs right into a nice hip lock by young Jimmy Powers. These guys have shown me some continuity. These young Stallions, nice single leg trip. Oh, look at that move.
It's a good move. I agree with you on that.
Oh.
I think they copied it from the Islanders, though.
You think so?
I think so. I know so.
I've seen the Islanders do that particular move on occasion, as well as Strikeforce. Of course, right now, the reigning World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions under the tutelage of Mr. Fuji, Axe and Smash Demolition, are just a little bit head and shoulders above everything else, are they not?
Well, they're the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions.
Well, they've got a little bit of an edge now, too, because Mr. Fuji, the devious one.
He certainly is.
He's a funny individual to have roaming around outside that ringside.
You know, I've asked Fuji for a...
Nice move there. Another big tag team combination here in the World Wrestling Federation is the Bolsheviks. We asked them earlier on for their views of the Young Stallions.
You know, Young Stallions, brothers, I have had, you understand, the opportunity to observe you in the ring. And the Slickster must admit that you are good. But comparing you to these two gentlemen is like comparing horseback to Cadillac.
Well, obviously the Bolsheviks would like to get their hands on the gold, but, you know, they're going to have to get by teams like these Stallions, by teams like Strikeforce. And well, you know, Fabulous Rougeau. Let's not forget them.
Oh, did you say Fabulous?
I did, yes.
You know, there's so many great tag teams in the World Wrestling Federation.
Oh, look at that. Tag made, and Martel... Excuse me, Jimmy Powers stepping in. I got Strikeforce on my mind, Brian.
Well, you certainly do.
A nice move.
Anything you need to know, just ask me. I'll help you out here,
thank
pal.
Thank you very much.
Don't mention it.
Stone in for the ride. Gone downstairs with that one. Uh-oh, look out. Suplex coming up. Got him up, controlled him well.
You won't get him, though.
Ganter come in and made sure.
I'm not sure the Young Stallions are always tagging fairly.
What are you talking about? Are you watching? Are you paying attention?
Paying attention right here.
Oh, beautiful drop kick. He almost did a 360. He did. Right out of there and down flat on his back.
Look at this. Double teaming. Two on
Stone
one
Stone left in there all alone. The tag has been made. Look at this. Oh, no. Just put the lights off for that, youngster. Right now, we're going to take you to young Sam Houston, the Texan, and he knows what really tastes good.
You know, folks, after you've been riding a horse for a while and you're in that hot old Texas sun, there ain't nothing better than getting you a Superstars of Wrestling ice cream bar right here and taking a great big old Texas bite. All right, look.
Where is that ice cream guy? Gorillas like ice cream. Let's go back to ringside.
This event is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, accompanied by his manager, Bobby the Brain Heenan. Weighing in at 275 pounds, the mighty Hercules.
That's what it's all about.
And his opponent, from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, weighing in at 230 pounds, Bill Bowman.
Bill Bowman, this week here on Wrestling Challenge, taking on Hercules with that 15-foot steel chain wrapped around his neck only moments ago. There it is. Of course, that's a new one. If you folks remember correctly, not too long ago, the Ultimate Warrior snapped the old one. And the Weasel chant goes out as the Brain just completely ignored me, walked out away from the broadcast position. Didn't say I'm going down to ringside, just walked out. Does that all the time. Hercules, a real powerhouse. So many ways this guy can put you away, but that vertical backbreaker, his favorite. And he is another sadistic type individual. Big smile on his face as we look over the shoulder of the weasel. Picks him up like he weighed 100 pounds, when in fact he's up around that 225-pound mark. And we know you got the power, Hurt. He is put together. And since coming under the tutelage of the Brain, has really come a long way. Brain giving him some instruction here. He doesn't look like he needs too much instruction. He likes that bear hug, too. That was a sign he just gave. Take a good look. One of the premier managers of all time here in the World Wrestling Federation, referring to Bobby the Brain Heenan. Unfortunately, the gold has escaped him, but for how long, only time will tell. Oh, look at that. Just flung him halfway across the ring like yesterday's garbage. It would appear to me that Hercules could put away Bill Bowman at any particular point in time that he wanted to. As we stated earlier on, whenever he gets out here on Wrestling Challenge, he wants you to take a good look at it. Uh-oh, here it comes. There it is, the patented backbreaker. I don't know whether Bowman is even conscious at this point to say, yes, I do. But referee had enough smarts to ring the bell.
Here is your winner, the mighty Hercules.
Hercules, most impressive here this week. The Brain happy. Kurt Gall was happy. Big smile on his kisser. He's a powerhouse, and Bowman just wasn't any competition for him.
Hercules, indeed, impressive. What are the plans for Herc? What do you got lined up for this guy?
Oh, I've got a lot of things.
Has he got a match lined up with the Macho Man for a championship belt?
Well, nothing's really...
Involved in tag team stuff? Or
nothing's really...
Go ahead, tell us what...
Well, I'd like to if you'd quit.
You're not out on the boat now. You don't have to get excited and get upset.
So
just tell
again.
The folks what Herc's going to do. The floor is yours.
You're not going to interrupt me.
No.
Well, what Hercules and I are planning is, or has been, and will be, is
probably
going to have
not
a
be. Go ahead.
We're going to have a meeting with Jack Tunney. We're going to lay out the negotiations. We're going to lay out what percentage we want, what percentage Savage will get. And you just named the time, place, and where, and you've got that match with Hercules and him.
You don't have the championship belt. You don't tell people what you want. They will tell you what they want. Don't you understand how things work?
I don't think you... If I had a phone here, I could get this all done.
Plenty of good news, but coming up next is bad news. Look at that.
He's made no effort. Come on, ref. No, he's made no effort to pin the man.
This is all good news here, Brains.
So is this.
What's
the giant ice cream bar from Andre the Giant.
There is no giant bar from the WWE.
Allied.
You're something else. That reminded me, though, of the 2x4 was about that length, or maybe a little bit longer.
It was about this high, the 2x4.
Clobbered, put the wood to the big guy.
What were you going to say?
Well, I was going to say that we have all kinds of good news, and some of it is this WWE fan club, which we'll give you further information on later on, but right now we've got bad news. So let's go to ringside for Bad News Brown.
This is bad news.
Introducing first, from Green Bay, Wisconsin, weighing in at 228 pounds, Chris Czarna. And his opponent, weighing in at 271 pounds, from Harlem, New York, Bad News Brown.
Bad news with a taped right hand.
He's bad.
I believe that Chris Czarna is in for a rough evening, shall we say, man.
Ooh.
Ah.
Ooh.
This guy obviously had some very serious training in the martial arts somewhere along the way, because he uses some devastating moves. And incidentally, I think it's only right to warn the youngsters, the millions of youngsters out there watching, that these moves are not to be tried at home. The moves at the... Oh, look at that. moves just like that one right there are extremely dangerous. And if you're not a professional, a skilled, trained professional, please, youngsters, do not try these moves at home.
And for all the guys, don't let your wife work you over either.
Oh, will you stop? Look at that. Plants a right hand right into the esophagus area of young Chris Zarna.
You know, bad news Brown here. He not only can wrestle, he can box, martial arts, and he's probably the toughest man ever to come out of Harlem.
Well, that remains to be seen. Got a lot of tough guys here in the WWE.
Oh, a lot of tough guys.
As you well know. In fact, Brian, if you picked up the latest edition of the WWE magazine and read the personality profile column, which was on Bad News.
I read it twice.
Oh, what did it say?
It's for me to know, you to find out.
Yeah.
Why don't you buy it and read it?
Tells us all about Bad News and how he went from the streets to the ring.
You know, being raised in the streets of Harlem isn't like walking around in downtown Beverly Hills. It's pretty rough.
Yeah, well, I understand that Beverly Hills is getting a little rough, too, now. Especially in your neighborhood.
A great neighborhood. You couldn't get in my neighborhood.
Bad news, you notice Brain looking around every once in a while, making sure the hitman is not in the vicinity.
You know why?
Yeah, I know why.
Because if he sees a hitman, he's going right for him.
That was a smart move by Zarna there to get himself out of the ring as he was taking a tremendous amount of punishment. But unfortunately, he had to get back in here. He got counted out. That might have been the lesser of two evils. Look at that.
He's made no
effort. Come on, ref.
You know, he's made no effort to pin the man. He really enjoys torturing this guy.
He's a very sadistic individual. Referee getting on his case now, but a little bit late, I think. Irish whip now by the big guy.
Ooh.
Knows where to hurt you.
Just didn't kick him. He planted that in.
Sure did. Setting him up again.
Oh! I want to see that ghetto blaster.
Well executed clothesline there.
Oh, here it comes, I bet.
Look out. Yes, indeed. Oh, he nailed him right on the back of the head with that ghetto blaster.
One of my favorites.
Now, look at this humiliation move here.
Garbage.
Oh, come on.
Garbage. You
That's disgusting.
He's yelling garbage.
Let's get the word.
Here is your winner, Bad News Brown.
Bad News Brown, very impressive. However, Zarna didn't put up a whole lot of competition for him, did he?
I think the man was scared from the beginning.
Yeah. I'd like to see the hitman in here and get a chance to do a number on Bad News.
There's a symbol here, but I'm not sure I'm getting it.
It's a power symbol. What's wrong with you? Don't you know anything?
Look at this. Right from behind on the back of the neck, the ghetto blaster.
Right on the external occipital protuberance, which puts the lights out for
you. Will you keep it simple for these humanoids?
I'm sorry.
He nailed the guy.
Ghetto blaster, indeed, a very vicious type move, and you know he's gonna put somebody out of commission permanently if he's not careful with that.
Probably Bret Hart if you don't watch him.
Yeah, well, there's a guy that he better be looking over his shoulder for, because the hitman is indeed looking for Bad News. It's going to be Bad News.
Why? Because Bad News outsmarted him in the battle royal.
No, he didn't outsmart him. He double-crossed him. It's a different word, Brain. Outsmart and double-cross.
Well, there are no friends in a battle royal. Everybody's trying to win. They're all individuals. And sure, he shook his hand and told him that.
What does that tell you? Doesn't that mean anything? A shake of the hand? I guess
not in a battle royal.
With the kind of people you associate
with. You know, I'd even double cross you in that.
I'm sure you would. I know you would.
I would.
You were prepared to do that last week till you got stuck out there on the water.
Gave me a guy that used to drive arcs.
Are you kidding? Talk about big matches. We indeed have one coming up in mere moments here. Our feature this week on Primetime Wrestling, referring to Bam Bam Bigelow as he takes on one of the prime people of the Heenan family.
King Kong Bundy.
We'll be back in a moment.
Hit it.
Feature time here this week on Primetime. Roll it. We're not ready to roll it. What? Remember the last time you said roll it? The engine wouldn't start. Do you remember that? I hope you had your fill of
boating, yachting.
Incidentally, if you look around, Brain, you'll see that I have rehired all the folks that you fired last week.
They're all back.
Yeah, they are. They are. Let's go to our feature right
now. You guys
did
a heck of a job last week.
Kicking on Bam Bam Bigelow.
Care what he says.
About to enter the ring, the manager, Bobby the Brain Heenan. And he represents from Atlantic City, New Jersey, weighing 460 pounds, King Kong Bundy.
King Kong Bundy probably close to 500.
And his opponent to be led towards the ring by his manager, Oliver Humperdinck, from Asbury Park, New Jersey, weighing 393 pounds. Bam! Bam! Bigelow!
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside with his lordship, Alfred Hayes, here in Madison Square Garden for this gigantic matchup. I hope they've reinforced the ring, your lordship.
I certainly do, too. There's two huge men in the ring there. And as you say, Bundy, close to 500 pounds, and Bigelow, close to 400 pounds.
Well, I'd like to see this turned into a tag match, your lordship, and get the Brain in there along with Oliver. And this would really make it interesting.
It would, you know, but strangely enough, the Brain is not a bad wrestler. He's pretty competent. He doesn't wrestle too much these days.
Well, that sign certainly had a lot to say. I couldn't make out the last line there, but certainly where there's smoke, there's fire. And in Bam Bam Bigelow's case, those lightning rods, this guy has got speed and agility that a guy his size shouldn't possess.
It's incredible, isn't it?
Certainly
he can throw a drop kick along with the best of them.
Well, one from Atlantic City, one from Asbury Park, only about 40, 50 miles apart. Now, this could be, I don't know, the New Jersey Championship at stake here.
I thought Texas was the place where they bred all the big men. Obviously, they've got them in other parts, too.
They certainly do.
He is a big, impressive, and awesome man, Bundy.
And neither one of these guys has to spend a lot of money on hair oil. Look out. Ducked underneath, a nice right hand. Whoa!
Oh!
Down went Bundy. Look at the cartwheel by Bam Bam. He's exploding now.
That's the first time I've seen Bundy go down from a tackle.
Hard into the corner. Look out. Telegraph that one. About a half a second slow. Bam Bam with the elbow. Could be all over early. Two count. Nope, couldn't hold a big guy down.
Only just, though. Bundy had a lot of trouble coming out of that.
Look at the Brain stomping around there. He's worried.
Bundy was very slow coming to his feet, too. I think the big man has been stunned.
Your lordship, you know, with all the things that Bobby the Brain Heenan's got going for himself, never has he had a title, a championship belt in his stable.
Isn't that incredible?
How could you count for that?
There must be something slightly in
error. Oh, he nailed him with that clothesline. Tide has turned in this one. King Kong Bundy for the cover. Two, no. Right shoulder came out of there. Snuck out the back door. Heenan complaining to the referee about the count. I thought he was right there.
He was definitely right there. And that shoulder did come up, but it was so close to a three count. Oh, listen to those blows.
Oh, 360 done by Bam Bam. As he got clotheslined again, he's down on the concrete. Humperdinck go over there in a hurry to take a look and sort of protect his man.
And he's really slow coming to his feet here. He's in danger of being counted out.
Brain looks a little more confident now.
Yes, he certainly does. He looks a lot more confident.
And Bundy does as well. Once again, capacity crowd here in Madison Square Garden.
Bam Bam going through a difficult few moments here. He took that tremendous 360 out of the ring. And since then, he hasn't been able to do much at all.
Got about Excedrin headache number 27. Might take him good, be a good idea. Just take a walk around the ring. Try to shake loose the cobwebs. There he goes now. That's a good idea, Bam Bam.
Yes, he should take his time a little more.
Bundy with an Irish whip now. Oh, another vicious clothesline. Just about decapitated Bam Bam.
Twisted him in midair, too.
Big splash. No, he tried to drop a knee. Bam Bam long gone. A splash of his own. This could be it. One, two, it's over. Oh, the Brain won't like this.
What a great victory by Bam Bam.
Right in the center of the ring in Madison Square Garden. Bam Bam Bigelow on to victory. Congratulations by Humperdinck.
Bam Bam Bigelow.
Wow. You weren't, that brought back some memories, did it not, Brain? You weren't too thrilled that night in the garden, I understand.
Oh, I could say something, but you'd twist it around.
Oh.
Try me.
No, I don't talk about the referee's count or the holding.
Are you questioning that count in that particular match?
Or holding of the tights and
all the things that your guys do so well, you're questioning all those things? I don't understand that.
You should roll to something.
Roll to something? Yeah, I'd like to roll to you. You're upset, and I understand
that. You didn't have to show that
piece of
film.
You don't have your telephone. I guarantee you next week we'll have a telephone here for you.
What happens when I pick up the receiver? Something shoot through my ear and deafen me?
No, I don't think that.
Does a mouthpiece squirt water in my face?
No, I don't think so.
To shock me, maybe.
I think you were humiliated enough last week, don't you?
No, I don't think I was. I was sabotaged.
Well, folks, that wraps it up for this edition of Primetime Wrestling. I hope you enjoyed the program, which I'm sure you did, and I hope you like our new set. I think it's extremely nice and well done and in good taste. And no thanks to the brain. Next week, we'll be right back here, Primetime Wrestling, with an outstanding feature matchup for you. So until then, Gorilla Monsoon for the Navigator, saying so long, everyone. Say goodbye.
I want you.